So the Deepwater Horizon drilling rig caught fire on April 20th, 10 years ago and a day. It sank 36 hours later in the Gulf of Mexico. And the accident was due to a series of human errors, system and engineering failures, a number of events that linked together, causing this catastrophic event. 11 men were killed, 17 were seriously injured, and oil was released during the following 87 days in the Gulf of Mexico, releasing over 4 million barrels of oil in the Gulf over the following 87 days. There's 42 gallons of oil in a barrel, so you can do the math. It's an extraordinary amount of oil that was released at that time. This presentation marks the 10-year anniversary of the Deepwater Horizon accident and is used as an important case study in the Applied Engineering program at Kaiser University to highlight the human, engineering, economic, and environmental impact of such a catastrophic engineering event. The emphasis of the program and theme is failure engineering. This is what we focus on in the program at Kaiser. Failure engineering, learning how things work by learning how they break. I'll give you a brief bio, give you an opening scene to kind of set the mood. We'll talk a little bit about the drilling activities in the Gulf of Mexico. I'll give you a rig tour, show you some of the massive engineering equipment that takes place and the diversity of equipment that includes mechanical, electrical, hydraulic, pneumatic. We'll talk about the catastrophic event, the specific event itself, including the aftermath and capping the well. And then I'll give you a brief engineering analysis to kind of break down the events. I have a bachelor's, master's, and PhD in electrical engineering. I'm an engineer. I've been doing this for over 40 years. I've been involved and have experience in engineering industry and academia. I spent almost 4 years in the offshore drilling business and, in fact, was involved in a very similar accident on an oil rig not far from where the Deepwater Horizon incident occurred. I worked for a company called Sedco. They were based in Dallas, oil drilling and well service company. And during that time, I worked on three dynamically positioned drill ships, the 445, the 471, and the 472. I also worked on a dynamically positioned semi-submersible, which is the same class of vessel as the Deepwater Horizon. This was a Sedco 709. And during that time, we drilled, while I was on the rigs, we drilled off the coasts of Brazil, India, Spain, Shetland Islands, Nova Scotia, Ireland, and of course, we drilled in the Gulf of Mexico. And again, for those of you just joining me, I apologize. I can't see the texting if you're chatting or texting while I'm giving the presentation, so bear with me. I will check it periodically. I ask you to mute your microphones. I ask that you mute your microphones and turn your cameras off only to maximize bandwidth. And to avoid that. This is a crew change I was on. This is actually a helicopter flying out of Shannon, Ireland. We flew almost 3 hours, probably over 3 hours. Now, most Sikorsky S-61 helicopters don't have that range. So in order to achieve that range, what they did was convert this helicopter into a flying gas tank. It's literally what it was. The Sikorsky S-61 took, I think, over 3 hours. It was just a long droning for 3 hours. You can imagine what that does to you. We had, of course, they gave us headsets and we had orange survival suits, which in reality probably wouldn't have helped very much if we had gone down in that treacherous water in the North Sea. This is actually the first rig I was on. This is the Sedco 472. It's a 472-foot drill ship. It's a 212-foot derrick. This picture I took in the Lisbon Harbor in Portugal during time off there. And there's a handsome young man there in his late 20s. There I am working on the rig with my hard hat and my steel-toed boots. On the right side, you can see this is the blowout preventer. We had two blowout preventers on the rig. And if you look close, circle in red and white down here, you can see this man working on this massive structure. This is the structure that actually is connected, latched up to the wellhead, and then connected to the rig through riser pipes. And this is designed to protect the rig, prevent blowouts, prevent the escape of gas and oil from the rig, and allows us to basically control all the drilling operations once the stack is landed on the wellhead. In fact, it's the blowout preventer that was one of the problems with the Deepwater Horizon. They couldn't close the blowout preventer. They couldn't shut it in. And as a result, the hydrocarbons that entered the annulus and the wellbore made their way up to the drill floor, enveloped the rig, ignited, exploded, and ultimately sank the rig. This is actual oil that I recovered in the Godavari Basin off the coast of India in July of 83. We were drilling in a TD of 2,400 meters. And as you can see, this is actually crude oil. This is from the earth. It's now a tarry, black tarry, smelly material. But it gives you kind of a sense of what's down there, what we're after, what we spend all this time and effort and money going after, which drives this economy and drives the world. Now let's look at the Deepwater Horizon accident. Let's focus now and drill down, no pun intended, at the actual nature of the accident. Before I get started, I want to say that this information I will present today was collected from numerous sources, including congressional hearings, investigative reports, videos, and from my personal experience in the offshore drilling industry. Opinions expressed today are those of the author, mine alone, and not of Kaiser University. Now let's watch this opening scene to kind of set the stage. Here we go.
Holy shit! Doc, close the second annular!
Thrusters are running away from me. I'm not going to be able to hold the rig in place.
All right, calm down.
Is it just me, or just get real bright in there all of a sudden?
Yeah. Magenta. Morning. Magenta alarms.
Yeah. Morning.
The well is blowing out.
Hi.
Mayday, this is Deepwater Horizon. We are in a...
Yeah.
What the hell are you doing? Did I ask you to call it Mayday? You don't know the difference between a kick and a goddamn blowout.
Why is the...
You don't know shit.
Why is the monitor out? Mayday, Mayday. Mayday, this is Deepwater Horizon.
Oh!
Mayday. This is Deepwater Horizon. We've had a major explosion. We need assistance.
Jesus, she's on fire!
I repeat, we've had a mass casualty explosion. We need assistance immediately.
Mayday, mayday, mayday. This is Deepwater Horizon. Motor vessel. David Banks. Deepwater Horizon has exploded and is on fire. I say again. Deepwater Horizon has exploded and is on fire.
Unfortunately, to do it properly takes time.
43 days. 44 days.
Keep counting, Bob.
45 days. 46 days.
Have a cookie, Bob. Can't run a cement log. I'll tell you what we're going to do now. We're going to run a negative pressure test before we do anything else.
If you really think we need to...
Oh, my God. Who's on the bridge?
Leave us.
Good stuff.
Get your ass on my lifeboats.
All right. That was a scene from the film. We'll talk a little bit about that now. That scene was from the film Deepwater Horizon, which was released in 2016. When it came out, I had no interest in seeing it because after having spent almost 4 years in the industry, I was certain that Hollywood could not possibly preserve the authenticity and accuracy of the event. Well, I was wrong. In short, it brought me to tears. It was the most technically accurate, detailed, and authentic film I ever saw. And if you haven't seen it, you should. Let's now take a look at the drilling activity that takes place in the Gulf of Mexico. It gives you kind of a sense of just how close to home this was. And from a much higher perspective, gives you a sense of what's going on and what's been going on in the Gulf of Mexico for decades. Gulf of Mexico is one of the richest oil-bearing geographic locations in the world. As you can see, most of the drilling activity takes place at least near the coast of the U.S., along the coasts of Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, and Florida, which is more densely populated here. This shows the proposed activity of another pipeline or other activity. Now, there is drilling going on down in the northern part of Mexico in the Bay of Campeche, but we're going to focus right now on where the Deepwater Horizon incident took place, which was the Gulf of Mexico. The accident took place about 41 miles off the Louisiana coast. A water depth of 5,100 feet. Now I'm going to say that again, 5,100 feet. That's almost a mile down. If you think about that a minute, there's a vessel floating on the surface of the Gulf, and almost a mile below it on the ocean floor is where the blowout preventer sits and where it's latched to the wellhead. The rig is connected to the blowout preventer through a series of long pipes called riser. And then all the drilling activity takes place within that riser and then past the wellhead within the casing and into the geographic formation. The drilling depth was 18,360 feet. When the rig exploded, it was reported that people from all parts of the coast could see the flame and the explosion that night. Now what you see just to the left of it is the Setco 471. That was a rig I was on, and we encountered a very similar incident at night. One night, late at night, we had a vicious storm roll in. We were, I think, in about 3,000 feet of water. It was a 471 dynamically positioned drill ship. We lost all power on the rig. We were latched up to the wellhead, the BOP. We were latched up to the BOP, which was latched up to the wellhead. The riser connected to the rig, and we lost all power. So basically, we became a floating cork bobbing in the water in this violent, vicious storm that night. We had drill pipe in the hole, and I believe, if I recall, the hole was opened. We could not close the well in because we had no power, and I don't believe the fail-safe mechanisms on the blow-up preventer worked, which basically means we were in an open hole with drill pipe run, unable to disconnect in a violent storm. And of course, those are only several of the events that must take place for a catastrophic event to happen, like the Deepwater Horizon. I believe if we had an influx of oil and hydrocarbons enter the wellbore that night on the 471, and if it had ignited on the drill floor, I'm sure I wouldn't be here today. There are hundreds of different types of oil rigs and platforms that are designed and built and set out and used in the offshore drilling industry. I'm going to focus on three of them. On the far right, you see a jackup rig, which is exactly what it is. It basically is designed to drill in shallow waters. Three legs are jacked down just like a car, just like jack your car up. The legs are jacked down. Once they make contact with the ocean floor, jacking continues. The platform rises above, and then all drilling is handled at that level. In the middle is a semi-submersible. This is the class of vessel that the Deepwater Horizon falls into. Dynamically positioned, which means it can not only provide its own means of motion, of movement through the water, it's also designed to maintain its location with these huge, massive thrusters, which you'll see a picture of in a minute, that are located on the bottom of the pontoons. This is basically a massive structure built on columns that are mounted to pontoons that float in the water. You can see the drilling depth approximately 10,000 meters in a little bit deeper water. The drill ship is a third type of vessel. These are dynamically positioned. Again, they can move under their own power and maintain their own location in water depths and drilling down about 12,000 meters. I think the 471, the 472, as Fred was telling me the other day, I believe it was designed to drill in 6,000 feet of water. Well, here's the 472. I was on this drill ship, 472 feet, 212 foot derrick. Drilling takes place in the middle of the vessel. There's a 22 foot opening, big circular opening in the middle of the rig through which all the drilling takes place. There's a helipad in the back where the helicopter lands. Equipment, bays, storage bays back here. This is the living quarters. This vessel, I believe, could support a complement of about 90 people. The Deepwater Horizon, I think, had a maximum of 126 personnel it could accommodate. The 709 is a dynamically positioned drill ship. Semi-submersible. And again, you can see it's built on these huge columns, which are attached to the pontoons, which allow it to float. Very stable vessel. Here's your jackup. These are your two positions of your jackup rigs. These are legs extended, and this is with the platform raised. And this is the Deepwater Horizon. The Deepwater Horizon arrived at the Macondo Prospect in February of 2010, there in the Gulf of Mexico. It was designed to operate in water depths up to 8,000 feet to a maximum drilling depth of 30,000 feet. It was considered one of the most technically advanced rigs in the world. And by the way, it had just set the world record for the deepest well ever drilled at 35,055 feet in a water depth of 4,132 feet. Let's look now just a quick video of the actual Macondo well where the Deepwater Horizon was drilling. Gives you a sense of the proportions and the perspective of what was going on here.
BP drilled the Macondo well in over 5,000 feet of water. At these water depths, drillers can no longer use rigs that rest directly on the ocean floor. Instead, they use rigs that float on the surface. The Deepwater Horizon was a dynamically positioned rig. Its crew used satellite-based positioning technology to ensure that the rig stayed in position over the Macondo well. Sophisticated computers on the rig computed the rig's position based on the satellite signals and used that information to control powerful directional thrusters. These thrusters held the rig in place while it was drilling and could also move the rig from one job to another. The rig was connected to the well below by a steel riser pipe that was over 20 inches in diameter. The riser was the umbilical cord between the rig and the wellhead. The riser stretched nearly a mile down through the waters of the Gulf. As water depth increases, pressure rises, and temperature decreases, Sunlight begins to fade. The conditions at the seafloor were completely different than at the surface. It was perpetually dark. The pressures were intense, over 2,000 pounds per square inch, and the temperatures were cold, approximately 40 degrees Fahrenheit. The riser connected to the Deepwater Horizon's blowout preventer, or BOP, shown here in yellow. The blowout preventer, in turn, was attached to the wellhead, shown here in blue. The wellhead at the seafloor was the mechanical connection to the Macondo well itself. That well was lined with steel casing strings that reinforced and sealed the wellbore. From its start at the wellhead, over 5,000 feet below the surface of the Gulf, the Macondo well stretched over 13,000 feet down into the ocean floor and the geologic formations below. The rig crew drilled through miles of rock and sediments to reach the oil below. As they progressed, they set additional casing strings to reinforce the well, each smaller in diameter than the one before. The wellbore thus decreased from a starting diameter of 36 inches down to a final diameter of only 8 inches. As the crew progressed deeper into the earth, the miles of rock and seawater above exerted more and more pressure. The temperature also increased. By the time the Deepwater Horizon crew began drilling through hydrocarbon-bearing rocks, shown here in yellow, the pressures were over 12,000 psi, and the temperatures were over 150 degrees Fahrenheit. At the bottom of the last casing string was the shoe track, and finally, the reamer shoe at the end of the final string of casing. It was almost 3.5 miles from the pay sands at the bottom of Macondo well to the Deepwater Horizon's rig floor.
Now, take a look at that. This is an extraordinary feat of engineering here. The rig is floating on the surface of the water, and a mile below that rig is where all the drilling activity takes place, and through the well, as you can see, this is a blowout preventer here. The rig is connected to the blowout preventer with riser, as you'll see in a minute, and then the drilling takes place within that riser, and then within casing, which is set, as you heard, it went from 30 inches at the blowout preventer at the wellhead down to 8 inches at the very, very deep depths of the formation. Now I'm going to give you a rig tour, kind of give you a sense of what goes on the rig, all the variety. And so we'll do a rig tour now, let you see what goes on the rig. Two main methods of transportation to and from the rig are either by work boat or by helicopter. The helicopter can take as many as 2 or 3 hours. I was actually on a work boat at Halifax. It took us 12 hours to get out to the rig. There's a number of personnel that actually support this effort, and these are groups of people all working closely together and monitoring the activities at various levels. On the far left, you see the drilling crew. These are the folks that are directly involved with the drilling and all drilling aspects. It includes the tool pusher, the driller, the assistant driller, pump man, derrickman, and floorman. We also have a marine crew, because to them it's a boat, and we are registered as a vessel, as a marine going vessel, and so we have to have a captain, assistants, deck pushers, roughnecks, roustabouts, painters, welders, so forth. We also have electricians, a chief electrician, assistant electricians. These are the folks that handle everything electrical on the rig, no matter how big or small. Same thing with the chief mechanic. We have chief mechanics. They handle all mechanical equipment, hydraulic equipment, interface equipment, material coordinators, storekeepers, pursers, cooks, laundry. You go to bed off your shift. We're working 12-hour shifts, 24/7. You go to bed. You put your clothes out in the bag, you come back, when you wake up, the clothes of the night there, nice and washed and clean, ready to go. And off, and finally, on the far right, safety officers, we have a full-time medic and a radio operator on the rig. There are a number of service companies that support this effort. This is obviously a very diversified group of folks. Halliburton, who did a cementing job, Schlumberger, who was involved in a lot of the downhole characterization, well characterization, Sweco did the cement analysis, Sperry Sun with navigation, Weatherford, Cameron built the BOP and a lot of the drilling equipment, and of course Tidewater that handled all of the workboat activities. Now, at the heart of your rig is a power plant. Now, remember, this is like a floating city. It's no different than a small city. It has power generation, power distribution, distributed around the rig, accommodations to sleep, eat, shower, bathe, work, offices, and what have you. These are the engines that would power such a vessel. If you look now, these are eight engines. These are V20 engines, 20 cylinders each, massive diesel engines. These are connected to massive generators. The generators that were on the rigs I was on were typically 4160 volt, 4160 volt, three phase, what we called isochronous generators, just a fancy name. It generated electricity for all activity, all electrical activity on the rig. Needless to say, if these go out, you're pretty much a floating cork. Now, there were some redundant systems and backup, but these were the dominant systems. And in fact, the systems that were expected, that were suspected of exploding on the rig of the Deepwater Horizon. The reason for that, as I mentioned now, is these rigs basically are diesel engines. They intake air. What was happening that night as the oil and gas came up the wellbore, it enveloped the rig. These engines started sucking in all that methane and that highly volatile gas. They subsequently oversped. In the video you saw earlier, the Deepwater Horizon video, you saw light bulbs exploding and computer monitors exploding. That really happened because the generators were being oversped, causing much higher voltages than this equipment was designed to work with. Now, once this power is generated, it's going to be controlled, and it's controlled through a massive switchgear room manned by technicians and engineers. This is the distribution, load distribution, and management system on the rig. Now, as I mentioned, the rig is connected to the blowout preventer with riser, these big, long, connected end-to-end riser pipes. And the drilling takes place in that riser, through the blowout preventer, through the well, through the casing, down into the formation. All the while, there's a thick slurry of mud that's being pumped down that drill string. It squirts out the drill bit at the bottom, and it recirculates back up to the drill floor. Now, this requires massive pumps to do that. And these are the pumps you see here that perform that task. Now, the mud we're talking about, it's not mud in the normal sense of the word. It's a very carefully controlled property of a slurry that includes clay, barite, and other materials to maintain very specific and very carefully weighted rheological properties. And the mud performs three very valuable tasks or functions. Number one, it removes the cuttings from the formation and circulates them back up to the drill floor. Number one. Number two, it provides lubrication for the drill bit as it's cutting into the formation. And number three, because the entire drill string is filled with mud and the entire casing and annulus is filled with mud, it provides what we call a static pressure head. It literally keeps high pressure oil and gas from entering the wellbore and making its way up to the drill rig, to the drill floor. Now, that weight is very, very carefully monitored. If the mud weight is too heavy, there's a possibility it could fracture the formation, causing more damage than you want. If it's not weighted heavily enough, what happens then is the pressure from the formation overcomes the pressure from the static pressure head. And again, you've got gas and oil and hydrocarbons moving up the annulus and exiting on the drill floor. It's the only place it has to go. Now, when that mud is circulated back up, of course, it's got cuttings, it's got debris, it's got other material from the geographic formation, and we want to separate that out. We've got to separate that material out from the mud because the mud's reused. It's reused and pumped back down, and that's done with this piece of equipment. This is called a shaker table, and it's just analogous to panning for gold. We flow the mud over these shaker tables, and they're constantly shaking. It shakes out the material, the mud. Mud falls through the grating, the screen, and the screen then catches all the material and formation that comes up, and that's analyzed very carefully. On the Deepwater Horizon, they were getting pieces of rubber on the shaker table, and no one was paying attention to what was really going on. Well, that rubber actually ended up being one of the annulars, and that's a very critical part of the blowout preventer that's supposed to keep the oil and gas from coming up to the drill floor. These are thrusters. These are actually what's mounted on the bottom side of these vessels, massive DC thrusters. And as you can see, they rotate 360 degrees azimuth, and they can rotate completely around. And these are designed, what are used to move the vessel through the water, and more importantly, to keep it on location once it begins to drill. Now, you might want to ask yourself, and you might want to think about this a minute, the wellhead is permanently fixed to the ocean floor. The blowout preventer is mounted to the wellhead. And then the rig is connected to the blowout preventer via 5,000 feet of riser. But how do you think we do this? The riser is not moving. The blowout preventer is not moving. But the rig is heaving and rowing, rolling and pitching and yawing. How does that translate? And what mechanism do we use to allow that to even happen, where you have a vessel moving, perhaps violently sometimes, and everything else basically standing perfectly still? Well, this is done with the tensioner system you see here. And what you see basically are these huge piston cylinder mechanisms up here, these systems up here, there's eight of them, and they provide an upward tensile force on a collar that's pulling up on that huge, long 5,000 foot column of riser. It's pulling up on it. As I recall on the rig I was on, I think each of these cables was pulling had a tensile load of 10,000 pounds. But you multiply that times eight and you can see how much force is being pulled up, constantly being pulled up, and it bounces, it moves and heaves. You can see these big pistons up here moving in and out of these cylinders, allowing the vessel to move relative to this otherwise stationary riser. This is an actual picture of the riser. Here's your tensioners over here on the left, and here's an actual collar around the top of the riser. And this piece here basically is telescopic. It moves in and out, allowing the rig. This is actually connected to the drill floor. So the drill floor is moving relative to the riser. Now we have all kinds of pipes we use. This is the riser pipe. This is what's actually connecting the drill rig to the blowout preventer. These can vary anywhere from 13, 14 inches in diameter. And they're anywhere 30, 40, 50 feet long each. That white material you see is actually a buoyancy material. It's designed to keep these buoyant as possible. As I recall, I think they can provide up to 80% buoyancy on these otherwise massive pipes that are connected end to end. And as you can see, these are connected end to end and connect the blowout preventer to the drilling vessel. This is drill pipe, comes in all sizes, 6.5 inches, 5.5 inches, 4 inches, 3 inches. And not all drill pipe is steel. This particular pipe here, as you can see, it's a non-ferromagnetic material. And the reason for that is sometimes we run tools and electrical equipment down the drill pipe, and we don't want any interference from any magnetic fields being induced or created from the equipment. And as you can see, of course, here, this is where Howard Hughes made his billions, on the rotary planetary drill bit. So basically what you see here, these 6.5 inch drill pipe are connected end to end. A drill bit is connected to the very bottom hole assembly. And then it turns, the mud is squirted out the bottom of the drill bit and then recirculated back up to the drill floor. This is an actual picture of a drill. This is the drill floor. These are drillers running drill pipe. Looks like they're running it, I'm guessing, because he's got a swab in his hand, and he puts an anti-seize material, which connects the box end to the pin end of each of the drill pipe. You can see the box end is screwed into the pin end. I'm sorry, the pin end is screwed into the box end and then tightened with a machine, this massive machine here, and then lowered, and that process continues as we run pipe in. And then, of course, the process is reversed as we're running pipe out. They're pulling pipe out. This is the driller's hut. This protects the driller and any activity going on. You can see they have full access to sensors, screens. They have a good sense of what's going on, not just above the surface, but as below the surface as well. Now, this is the most important piece of equipment. This is the blowout preventer. And you can see it's a massive piece of equipment. It's a 450-ton system and is the primary safety device between the well and the drill floor. It sits on the wellhead and is controlled from the drilling vessel. It's designed with two fully redundant systems and can be split by separating the upper section from the lower section, effectively allowing you to escape in an out-of-control well situation. It's designed to work with pressures up to 15,000 psi, and you can see there's multiple layers of redundancy here, two annulars, five rams. These rams are designed to do a couple things. You've got shear rams, you've got blind rams. These are big, massive connections, closures that they're supposed to close. And if there's a drill pipe in the BOP, it's designed to either support the drill pipe where you can hang it off, or they actually can cut through cut right through that drill pipe like a knife through butter. And of course, those systems all failed the night of the Deepwater Horizon accident. Excuse me. It's also equipped with a battery-powered automatic mode function, or AMF device, which was designed as a fail-safe system. In case of loss of hydraulic pressure, electric power, and communications, it was designed to work automatically, which, of course, it did not do. So this was one of the last pictures of the Deepwater Horizon before the accident. You can see it was a marvel of engineering, massive structure. And it went from this to this. This is the result of the explosion that took place on the night of April 20th, 2010. And again, the cause was hydrocarbons entering the wellbore, coming out of the drill floor, enveloping the rig. A source of ignition was provided, perhaps by the engines. It ignited this gas, and this burned throughout the night. Attempts were made to put the fire out. No one even knew what was going on down beneath the water level. All they knew is they had a massive fire. 11 men were killed instantaneously at that explosion, and a bunch of others, most of the others, or all the others, actually jumped off. 17 were seriously injured. They were rescued. The rig burned the following day. In fact, it burned for 36 more hours. They were unable to put the fire out. It was being fed, of course, from the gas and hydrocarbons that had entered the wellbore, well below the ocean floor. The rig continued to burn. Of course, it can only withstand so much. You can imagine the scene from land, seeing this massive fire. And it continued to burn. At that point, once they realized what had happened, they realized 11 men were killed. 11 men were perished in this accident. These were just ordinary people doing their jobs. Families, kids. Very tragic accident. The well continued to flow for 87 days after that explosion, discharging over 4 million barrels or 168 million gallons of crude oil in the Gulf of Mexico. The results were devastating. The impact to the economic, environmental ecosystem in the Gulf of Mexico was beyond comprehension. As you can see, the oil spills, the oil slicks that developed shortly thereafter, it didn't take long for the oil to start coming up and begin to trace out patterns along the Gulf Coast there. Cleanup was just, it was considered futile at first, but they got the job done. Now let's talk about capping the well. The oil's blowing out, 87 days. They made many attempts to cap the well to close this thing in once they had an idea of what was really going on. Remember that well flowed for 87 days before it was capped. They didn't just sit there on their hands. They were attempting to cap this well. Many attempts of neutralizing the escaped crude oil, such as releasing dispersants. Closing in the well were made. Robots were used to unsuccessfully shut the BOP, the blowout preventer, which was still connected to the wellhead, by the way. Controlled fires were used on the surface to burn off the oil. Two relief wells were later drilled. A 98-ton containment dome was used to catch the escaping oil, but to no avail. What was happening was the water crystals were binding with the methane and freezing, and then it plugged up the hole in those domes and they became useless. Top kill and jump shots were used, dropping heavy tires, rubber balls, and cement into the well to stop the flow, all unsuccessfully. The well was finally capped on July 12th when BP landed or connected a 3-ram capping stack, built from scratch on the transition spool connected to the top of the blowout preventer. That's what you see here in the picture. This is the capping stack. This thing was designed and built from scratch during that time. The idea was if we could build it, land it on the top of the blowout preventer, we could then control the flow of oil, hydrocarbons, with this device. This became basically a series of valves. It was a triple ram system. Now, this is extraordinary if you think about what was really going on. This was happening, being controlled from a rig, a mile above the actual blowout preventer. So they were controlling this device using ROVs, as you'll see in a minute, from 5,100 feet above the surface of the water. And this is just an extraordinary feat of engineering. So with that capping, well, let's see exactly how that worked, and you'll get a sense of what really went on from 5,000 feet above the BOP. Aaron, I'll answer that question in just a minute. Good question. Now, there's no sound to this, so I'm going to kind of walk you through it. This is the actual capping stack that was used. Three rams, again, three big closure switches valved that they were trying to land. I'm going to speed it up here because this doesn't really take, nothing really happens for a couple of minutes, so I'm going to speed it up a little bit and get you closer to the actual landing. They made several attempts unsuccessfully, and they kept missing it. Now, remember, this is going on from a mile above, trying to land this. It's like putting a needle through a thread through a needle at a mile away. That's what they're doing here. And finally, with the help of these ROVs that you can see, they're helping position this massive structure into place with attempting to land it on top of the blowout preventer, which you can see is gushing oil all the while. Now, the valves were open. Obviously, they wouldn't be able to land it. The valves were open. They allow the oil to enter. Then once they latch it, they close the valves and they can control the valves, which is, in fact, how they subsequently capped the well with this very device here. And there you can see they landed it. There's the actual landing of the capping stack on top of the blowout preventer. Once that was it. That was the moment of truth right there. And these videos are all online. You can go online and you can look at these videos if you so choose. Okay. This picture was taken about the last year, actually. And this is a lonely little crab down there, which basically gives you some sense of what's been going on in the past 10 years. It isn't normal. It hasn't returned to normal. There's been some return of sea life, a variety of different types of sea life. But the devastation and the impact that this had is really beyond comprehension when you look at it from an environmental standpoint. Now let's look at the analysis. Let's analyze what happened, try to have an understanding of what went on so you can have a sense of really what took place and whether or not and why it was preventable. I'm going to tell you right now it was preventable, and I'll show you now why. But to recap, let's look at a comparison between industry standards and what BP actually did. Now, what you can see here on the left is the industry standard. The first one says full circulation, provide full circulation to the surface releases gas pockets. So full circulation releases gas pockets, ensuring the well integrity. What did BP do? BP failed to circulate the mud and jeopardized integrity of the well pressure. So things are starting to happen. This one, to assess the integrity of the cement job, a 9 to 12 hour test should be performed. BP ignored the testing that allowed pockets of gas, natural gas, to escape. Now you can see, here's the rig, here's the casing, I'm sorry, the riser, here's the blowout preventer. It sits on the wellhead. Below that's all the casing. Now you can see here, Halliburton recommended 21 centralizers. A centralizer does exactly that. It centralizes, it places the drill pipe and the casing in the center of the well. The reason it does that, is insofar as the drill pipe is concerned, to allow a space between the drill pipe and the casing for the fluid to move up. Halliburton recommended 21. BP decided to use only 6. Shorter casings allow greater control and accuracy. BP chose metal casings that were too long. When the warning signs arose through assessments before moving on, this is what you typically do. When you see warning signs, you stop. Warning signs were ignored by BP. Top plug trouble, intermittent gas bubbles, pressure increases, and there was fluid at the bottom of the well. This boils down to 4 fundamental events that took place that were ultimately the cause together of the Deepwater Horizon accident. There were 4 major things that took place that included the well integrity. The well integrity was compromised. It was never established and it failed. Hydrocarbons entered the well undetected and well control was lost. Now that means if you were listening, you heard the concept of the hydrostatic pressure head. That was gone. BOP didn't work, didn't close. Hydrocarbons ignited on the Deepwater Horizon. When the hydrocarbons came up and were forced up with nowhere else to go, they overflowed, enveloped the rig, ignited, and burned. And finally, the blowout preventer did not seal the well. And there's a brief description of further, but these are the four main events that took place. Now, here's the interesting thing. No one event, no single event caused this disaster. It was a result of a series of four major events, which collectively contributed to the disaster. Now, what's interesting is the absence of any one of these four events would have prevented the disaster from occurring. Now, I added an update this morning. I was listening to the news feed yesterday and heard some interesting information. I thought I would include it in today's presentation. Basically, the disaster was preventable, first and foremost. Let me back up. We talked about, here we go. Bear with me here, folks. So this was from yesterday's news feed. This is one of five capping stacks that have been developed and are now in standby at Corpus Christi, Texas. These capping stacks and many new tougher prevention and response policies and procedures have been put in place as a direct result of the Deepwater Horizon accident. We have taken action, and we do believe we are better prepared. Now, this is something that came out yesterday. Thad Allen, who is a Coast Guard general involved in the Deepwater Horizon response, he said, "I've gotten the question over the years, is it safe to drill?" His answer is, that's not the question, because there's no risk-free way to extract fossil fuels from the earth. He says, the question is whether the value of the resource is worth the risk of another disaster. He says, offshore drilling is safer now than it was 10 years ago, but he says we won't know if regulators and the industry are adequately prepared until the next accident happens. And finally, this was a classic blowout of a well that was being drilled in the most extreme of conditions, thus requiring extreme vigilance and attention to detail and safety. It was totally preventable. It was a classic blowout. I told you those four things that happen. When those four things happen, this is what happens insofar as the disaster takes place. Perhaps someday oil drilling will become a fully automated process controlled by machines instead of humans. If not, then we can be sure of one thing. This will happen again, and I just hope we are ready. Thank you for attending. I will, if we have time, I'll take a couple of questions. You can turn your mics on and your cameras now. Again, I appreciate all of you attending. And I have recorded this, by the way, and it will be available in a downloadable format, if you like. And I hope you enjoyed it. And if there's any questions or any comments, I invite you to submit them. And my students, if you would hang in there, I've got my students with us who joined us today. We will be resuming our normal class, and we got almost about noontime, so we have a few minutes to resume. Thank you. I have time for some questions. Any questions? Sure.
This is Dave. Hi, Dave. I remember that they were drilling some kind of lateral connections into Macondo. They were going to try to cap it with mud or cement. What was the result of that effort?
That's exactly right. Those are called relief wells, and actually two relief wells were drilled. The problem with the relief wells, what basically happened was they didn't finish the relief wells until after the well was capped. What they did use them for was to pump in cement and thereby close in the well completely. So yeah, those were used, and those were again typical classical methods of closing in these kinds of wells. And think about that a minute. This is a relief well, so they drill down, and then they had to turn the drill bits and drill horizontally and find that column where that well is. It's only about maybe 10 inches in diameter, if that, 8 or 9, 10 inches. And they're not going blind, of course, but they did have to run in drill pipe, pull the drill pipe out, run in sensors, locate the column, pull the sensors back out, run the drill pipe back. Very tedious, technically challenging problem, process.
Cool. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, Milo. I appreciate your comments. Well, I'm available. If anyone has any questions offline, feel free to contact me anytime. You have my, there's a question from Jeff Cathy. I see a hand up.
Dr. Athan, test. Test 1, 2, 3.
Roger. You're Roger, Captain. Read you loud and clear.
I've got some Navy pilot friends that back about 10 years ago started a company called Check Six that go out to these deep water drilling rigs. As you showed that rig org chart, they're into the safety factor and checklist and so forth. Any insight into how that's working and how effective it might be?
I know exactly who you're talking about. We may have had this conversation because what they were doing, it was a brilliant business model. They were teaching, in a nutshell, they were teaching rigs how to operate like the military, with checklists, with redundancies. It was phenomenal. And I've lost track of them, but this was 10 or more years ago, maybe 20 some years ago, they had a profound impact, and their business model was embraced, and I thought adopted, because it was so successful. It gave the offshore industry a new level of performance, a new level of quality control, and certainly a new level of safety. And I do remember that.
Yeah, thank you. Great presentation.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? And again, feel free to contact me anytime offline. This video is being recorded. We will make it available to you if you like.
Yeah, thank you so much, Stephen. Appreciate it very much.
My pleasure. Thank you for joining us, and thanks for your support.
You're very welcome.
All your help. Appreciate it very much, Glenn.
Take care now.
Okay.
Yeah, great presentation, Steph. Very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm glad you enjoyed it. It was unexpected doing it from my home, but as we all know, we make use of what we have, of the resources we have.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
What would you have done?
I'm sorry?
What would you have done if you were on the rig?
Probably what I almost did that night in the Gulf, jump off the rig. I've been told if you watch the congressional hearing of Mike Williams, who lived through it, he says the explosions were so violent, they took your breath away and blurred your vision. Now I cannot imagine any situation like that where I was expected to perform my normal duties. I think that night I'm pretty confident I would have jumped overboard. I mean, I wouldn't have even thought about it because you know, 2 years ago there was a land rig in Oklahoma that blew out, and very similar situation, a land rig in Oklahoma 2 years ago. And while the oil and gas was started blowing out through the drill floor, three of the men had ran into the driller's cab, and the two others that were left on the drill floor ran in the driller's cab. When the oil ignited, the gas ignited, they were incinerated. They all were killed instantly. So you got to think. You got to be thinking. And I remember one thing one of my buddies told me, John Butts. I'll never forget this guy. He told me, when you go out on these rigs, you always have an out. Always have an out. Always have a backup plan. Always have an escape. And I never forgot that. Thank you, Fred. Appreciate that. Any other questions or comments? Thank you, Elsa. Thank you for this. Yeah,
that was really great. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I kept thinking I should have invited my students to watch this.
Well, you know, we can do it again. If you'd like, we'll do another one. If you'd like, we'll invite your students. I'd love to do that. And if you're so nasty, Elsa.
I'm so nasty. Hope all goes well.
Thank you very much. You take care and be safe.
Take care. Thank you. Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? All right, let's see who's online here. Aaron, I see you there. AJ, good to see you. David, glad you could join us. Now, I don't know who's left us and who's still with us. So, Ms. Fitzgerald, your video camera's on so I can see your face. There we go. How do we get the presentation? Wait, I missed that. Let me see what that said. Bill asked, how do we get the presentation? Fascinating discussion. Thank you. I'm planning on uploading it to YouTube. I know I saved it and it is downloadable. If to make it available to all of you, I'll make the effort to put it up on YouTube. Give me a couple hours anyway to kind of get this in. But and if you don't see it, you can't find it, don't spend time looking for it. Just email me or contact me, sathan@kaiseruniversity.edu, and I'll be happy to set you up. I'd be more than happy. Okay, any other questions?
Professor?
I heard someone.
Hello, can you hear me?
I barely hear you there. Who is that?
Hello, this is Aaron.
Hi, Aaron, how you doing?
Hi, I have one question. So,
yes, sir.
What happens if, like, the drill bit at the bottom breaks? Like, are you, like, would they have to pull all the pipes up to replace it? Or would a diver go down there? And
no, that's a great question, AJ. Aaron. And here's what you got to picture. If that drill bit breaks, or if you've got a pipe that breaks, and by the way, the Deepwater Horizon a couple of years ago, in fact, on this well, I believe, they dropped a couple of drill pipes down. They had to go fishing after them. There's all kinds of specialty drilling equipment that you can use, because we know we're going to drop things down the hole. We're going to lose pipe. We have just tons of different kinds of equipment that's used for a variety of these scenarios. It can get bad where you lose it and don't recover it, but if that's the case, you close in the well and you move on. But that's a great question, and it happens. Don't think it doesn't happen. It happens. It happens all the time. Okay. Any other questions?
I have one, Professor.
Yes, sir.
What's the, as a person that's in that you say you have been experienced, what's is more exposed, like it's most valuable to fail?
I'm sorry, most valuable to what?
Fail. Like what's the key part that's likely to fail?
You mean it? In so far as the accident was concerned?
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, again, there were a number of things that happened, not any one of which would have caused that accident by itself. The biggest problem here, though, and I want to be careful, but when I say this, is that decisions were made on the rig, AJ. They were made for the wrong reason, we believe. And again, that's from testimony I read. Decisions were made to cut costs. Decisions were made to speed up the process, to hurry up. And when you do that in a highly volatile situation like that, you're bound to make mistakes. Sadly enough, you know, the bad news is this was a classic blowout. I mean, the good news is it was a classic blowout. They should have known better. They should have taken even more, been more vigilant, more careful, considering the risk involved at this deep depth. So many things could have gone wrong, and they look, in my opinion, and don't quote me on this, that this was an accident waiting to happen. Now, I think I may have even heard that in the video, so only when I said that, I'll deny it and I'll point them to the video. But it was an accident waiting to happen. It was just bound to happen, despite the efforts of BP. Let me read this. This is good. I think this is coming from Fred. I'd like to read this if you all don't mind. During the well abandonment, I'll read this out loud. The crew took mud from the well into a pit while simultaneously pumping mud from that pit to a workboat. The crew could not keep up with the displacement volumes, so they were not aware of the volume of the kick. This is really important. When you don't know, you should stop and assess. The crew assumed that the well was cemented and secure. You should always assume every gun is loaded. And if I may, Fred, if this is Fred Florence, This is Fred, an old friend of mine. He's an expert and subject matter expert really in this area in offshore drilling. He's been in it his entire life. We used to work together many, many years ago. I really appreciate that you would come and take the time and spend with us. This is a very important part of this process. A lot of things happened that shouldn't have happened, that didn't happen. And I encourage you all to read the reports. The reports are startling. The congressional hearings will just make you cringe at what some of the testimony you hear, what really happened on that rig. And if nothing else, if you do nothing else, watch the film, watch the movie Deepwater Horizon. I think that's a pretty accurate recreation of what happened. Any other questions or comments?
I have a question.
Yes.
Was there any legislation put in place after the accident to prevent this from happening?
Absolutely. There is a tremendous amount of congressional weight thrown around. I think Obama was the president at the time. There was a lot of things that were proposed. Some things weren't proposed. And in fact, some things changed. And I'm not going to be partisan here. All I'm going to tell you is a lot of things were proposed. Some things were put in place. Some things were not put in place. And even those decisions were changed when President Trump was elected. And again, I'm not taking sides here. I'm just saying it's a very volatile discussion and conversation. One thing that keeps coming up is if they're ever going to be drilling off the coast of Florida. It's a very highly debated discussion, and I don't know the answer to that. You know, this is an opportunity in our lifetime, and that opportunity is to consider other alternative sources of energy. We rely so heavily on oil and gas that we often don't think about the implications of scarcity. Although I read this, I think a gallon of or a barrel of crude oil, I think dropped. I read where a barrel of Brent dropped below $25 a barrel. So this is a very heated discussion and debate at all levels. But again, the point here was to raise awareness. And raise our awareness of what's going on in the industry. From an engineering standpoint, it's an incredibly interesting and compelling industry. One I was thrilled to be a part of. In fact, it makes up probably one of the most exciting times of my whole life. Those years I spent in the oil business. Any other questions or comments? John, how you doing? I see you there. I don't hear you. I have no sound.
About now.
I hear you loud and clear.
Okay, good. Is would you go back to the industry if you had the opportunity?
No. I'm too old and I'm too beat up. I loved it. I loved being a part of it. I love the engineering part of it. I could not have asked for to be placed in a better situation when I was hired. I was sent right to the 472. My first rig was off the coast of Brazil, drilling in the Amazon Basin, and I got to tell you, it was an eye opener. It was thrilling. I couldn't get enough of it. You know, as a single male man with no responsibilities to be able to do that in those days and travel around the world and be paid for it, it was incredible. I don't think I could ever reproduce that situation. No, it was thrilling. It was a chance of a lifetime. Any other questions? Well, I think what we're going to do, my students are with us. If you want to bear with us, we'll just take questions till 12:15, and then we'll reconvene on Thursday. I'll send you an emails of what to expect on Thursday. Students of mine, I see you there. Hannah, nice to see you. Aaron, AJ, David, good to see you. Any other questions? Emilio asks, what was the oil barrel price at that time? Hey, that's a great question. That's a great question. I'm going to make a note of that. It was 19. You mean 2010 during the Deepwater Horizon or during the time I was on? Which time are you referring to? Both. Okay. That's a great question. I don't have an answer for that, but I'll look that up. I'm wondering, gosh, you know what? I think oil is cheaper right now than it was during both of those times. I can only assume, but that's a great question, Emilio. Good thinking. Good question. Any other questions? Comments? Discussion? What year were you working? I was there from 80 to, I'm sorry, 82 to almost 86. I was there about 3.5 years, about 85, 86 time frame. I remember the day. It was January 16th, 1982. I took my first trip to the oil rig down in South America. 102 dollars, April 2010. No way. April 2010. Fred says 79.48. Wow. So $80 a barrel in 2010. That's amazing. Wow. Well, it had to be less than that in the 80s, in the early 80s. It had to be less than half that. So here we go. If it was 80, it had to be 40. It had to be, gosh, it was more than, it might have been more than it was, more than it is right now.
Well, if I may say, the Arab oil embargo in 74 and then 77, so I remember going from 25 cents a gallon to 50 cents a gallon, and then somewhere after that to a dollar plus.
Well, if it was 25 cents a gallon, I mean, think about that a minute. 25 cents a gallon, I think I paid, what did I pay the other day for gas? 250 or something? Or was it $2? Well, maybe even $2. But that was with today's prices. Now, if it was 25 cents a gallon, it had to be just incredibly cheap at that time, a barrel of oil.
My time reference is back to the Arab oil embargo from 74. And then 77. I remember that being that age, going to school, driving past the gas stations. As a kid. 25 and 50, wow. And then a dollar within a few years after that. I'm saying dollar would have been about 1979 or 1980.
Hey, Rudy says $64 in January of 85. Wow, that's very compelling, extraordinary. And this is it. This is how we do it. This is what goes on. Use link above, see graph 1970s. Oh, this is good. Okay, I'll do that right now. Cut and paste that. Let me go over here. Open up a window. And let's see here. Oops, what happened here? Oops. Okay. I'm going to open up a window here. Paste that URL and let's see what comes up. Here it is. Historical oil price. Wow. 2010, 2009, 2008. 31 more rows. Yeah, that's a good chart right there. Oh my goodness. Wow, look at that. Look at that. They even showed 2020, it dropped below $20 a barrel. This is accurate to today's prices. It started off before 1950. It starts at 1946 all the way through today. Let me see, is that right? April 2020, yeah, $14.83 a barrel. This is insane. Wow. Yeah, this is insane. I mean, and it's got to come from somewhere. And we're drilling in deeper waters, more treacherous, dangerous scenarios. But some interesting information. And what's interesting, the Deepwater Horizon, as much oil as it spilled, or as much oil as was released, it does not hold the record for the most oil released in an incident. I got a quiz for you, trivia quiz. Anyone know what the most the incident which released the most amount of oil, far exceeding that of the Deepwater Horizon? There's only one incident that beats the Deepwater Horizon in terms of how much oil was released. Who knows what that incident was? Anyone know? I'll give you a hint. It had nothing to do with drilling.
Was it Exxon Valdez?
Oh, no.
Okay.
The answer is it was the war, the Gulf War. Was it Hussein dumped three or four times that into the the Suez there, the river, the waterway there. In fact, I had that data here. Let's pull it up. Let me look at that real quick, because now I'm curious what the actual number was. Let's see. Here we go. Actually, here's some compelling, very compelling information I'll share with you. This is the number of casualties by vessel, the number of casualties from rig accidents. The most casualties was 167 in July of 88 on the Piper Alpha. This was a huge disaster. Unfortunately, and sadly enough, it was caused by human error. And actually, the Deepwater Horizon ranks number 11 from a blowout. Not that it's any less compelling. It did dump the most oil, second to Kuwait, in the Persian Gulf, rather, during the war. They dumped, he dumped 9 to 12 million barrels in the Persian Gulf at that time. BP ranked second, 4 to 5 million. And Ixtoc in 79 ranks third with 3.3 million. It's the Gulf of Mexico as well. And then these go down from there, 2.1 million. Atlantic Empress, land rig in Uzbekistan, oil pipeline in Russian Arctic, multiple platforms in the Persian Gulf, Castillo de Belvoir tanker, and there's the Amoco Cadiz. That's a Cadiz tanker off the French coast, ran aground, dumped 1.6 million barrels of oil at that time. So this is a pretty devastating, pretty risky industry. I guess you could look at it two ways. John, you're working in a area of industry where your focus is on coal rather. So
I was in the coal-fired power generation, but I'm in natural gas now.
Okay,
it's a different beast. I would say that it's a lot of things. To me, I speak from my personal opinion. I think it's better. I think that we can go from a central dispatch command to start to online and really building load within 30 minutes, provided all equipment's lined up. It's about a 30-minute window between you get the initial command to fire it, the igniters do their work, and you come up to a certain speed, it ties online, and then you continue to add fuel flow and ramp it up, and you can be at 800 megawatts in, you have to be there within 8 hours.
Wow.
You have a time window for environmental controls and concerns. Wow. But you can be at a load like that within 2 or 3 hours.
Interesting. Very interesting. Any other comments or questions? Feel free to submit or jump right in. Anyone, if you like, any questions? Fred's with us. If you have any specific questions on the in-depth questions on the oil business, Fred can help me out with those. John, as you heard, has been in this industry for many, many decades. Worked originally in coal. He's now in natural gas, power generation.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I hear you.
Okay. Basically, I'm in my second decade, and the long story short, as long as possible, is that in me making the transition, what we can do faster, better, easier on the human body, all sorts of different things that way. And even from an environmental standpoint, if those that are really interested in that, it's a great deal better. It's a whole lot less, far less of a pollution concern. A great deal smaller in terms of a waste stream. That's what I would say.
Interesting. Wow.
And the heat and efficiency. I think we're about 50% efficient.
Wow.
And it's pretty striking as to just how much steam, heat energy is released to generate steam to get that extra load. So I'll stop there unless you have another question.
Well, that's awesome. That's great stuff. You know, this is the infrastructure that most people don't know or care about. what's going on, where their electricity comes from, where the power comes from. And yet it's the lifeblood. I mean, there's no question about it. We are so reliant on these various sources of energy, and particularly oil and gas. It's kind of scary sometimes when I think about the implications of it going away or it being suppressed or limited in any way. And I, you know, I hope people are getting a sense of false sense of security based on what's going on right now. We should all be learning tons of information from what the world is going through right now from every level. I mean, energy, safety, medical. These are extraordinary times. Fred says lots of automation efforts underway, especially to keep people out of harm's way. Well, that's interesting. Removed from rig floor, but still on the rig, is becoming common. Now think about what he's saying here. This is all becoming automated. I believe it's what he's saying. Some remote operations, such as remote directional driller. That's incredible. This is exactly what I was alluding to earlier when I said, if the process isn't automated, you know, what's the implications? And it is becoming automated. Quite frankly, I can't wait till it's automated. I can't wait till we have self-driving cars, because the plan there, of course, is to minimize the number of fatalities caused mostly by human error. Even as a pilot, I cringe every time I hear of an aviation accident caused by pilot error. And there's a lot more pilot error accidents than you think there are. So human error is a big issue, big deal. And maybe now is the time, better time than ever before, to begin to. Well, I'm sure we've been looking at automating these processes. But we've got to keep working hard at implementing. I'm surprised. I guess one of the things I was a little surprised with, having read about the Deepwater Horizon, it was the most sophisticated rig in the world. I guess if my takeaway is you can have the most sophisticated rig in the world, and if people make mistakes, and you still have disasters. And that's pretty much what happened. I mean, that blowout preventer was incredible. It was so big and massive and designed to such specifications. And yet all that technology, as well designed as it was and well intended, was not used, or was used in the wrong way, or not used at all, in fact. But gives you a sense of gives you a real sense of importance here when you look. You look at what really is going on, and every single part of that from an engineering perspective, and I love looking at it from an engineering perspective. It's all connected, highly connected, and information has to be shared and analyzed carefully. You cannot become complacent. You can't rush. It's an old legacy. Unfortunately, it happens. And again, it was a classic blowout. I mean, the things that happened have happened before. And those are the things that happen when a blowout occurs, whether it's a land rig or a deep water rig or well. But any other questions? I think what we'll do is we'll go to 12:30 and then we'll conclude then. But no one else has any questions. I appreciate everybody coming. And again, I have a video copy of this that we're recording now. In fact, I'm going to run until the end, and I will make the video available. Of course, it'll be available if I can get it up on YouTube, which I plan on doing. I'll try to get that done today. Probably put something like Deepwater Horizon accident, maybe 2020. That's what I'll call it. I'll call it whatever exactly what it was called.
Hey, Dr. Ethan, could I say something?
You bet.
Regarding what you're saying, the level of complexity and so forth of the rig, I think it's an important point to be aware of that. I mean, I'd like to see some things automated in a way, but I've also seen where automation gets in the way. So I'm not negative. I've seen where you deal with permissives and interlocks that it's so involved that you can't run it if you have to in an emergency, things like that. So that's a different experience. But the one thing I would say when it comes to being able to be safe, like, slow down, take the time to do things right. What I'm seeing, what I've seen in the last, I'd say the last 10 years, is really the ability to communicate. Even for someone to be able to speak so clearly that no one can misunderstand is the key point. to be able to take the engineering skills and convert it to whichever audience you're dealing with, whether you're dealing with the janitor, the mechanic, the instrument mechanic, the CEO, the job scheduler, or, you know, the guy at the engineering desk somewhere away from you that you've got to interact with to get your part of a project done working right. And I think that's really, that's one of the biggest keys that I've seen. So while everybody makes the effort to become good at engineering, to become good at their skill, their craft, I think that communication piece is something everybody needs to take time to invest in. And I think, not calling any particular books, but one that really opened my conversations, and another one called Never Split the Difference by Chris Voss. He's the guy that was formerly a hostage negotiator for the FBI.
Yeah.
And he talks about being able to communicate like that. So that's just a point of reference I would share from my many years of work experience.
Interesting. Here's a comment. He says, I agree with Aaron. Lots of automation effort today includes human in the loop, not just how to automate, but how to hand control back to the driller. That was for John. This is great. This is great stuff. I mean, this is real in your face kind of stuff that you don't, this is not stuff you screw around with. I tell you, it was an eye opener for me when I went out there. I wasn't expected at all with respect to what I got myself into. And it was challenging and fun. And I got to tell you, I'm just thrilled I got through it and lived through it because you know, sometimes you get mesmerized with what's going on around you. I'll tell you what, I remember my buddy John Butts, big driller from Canada. He told me one day, I said, John, if you had some advice to give me, first, I'll tell you what he really said, the truth of what he really said. He says, I said, John, what advice would you give me to be safe? And he said to me, stay the H off the drill floor is what he first told me. And he's kind of calmed down and he says, well, you know, the best thing you can do is always have an out. And, you know, just watch yourself, watch around you, pay attention, you know, that level of awareness, it's just beyond comprehension. And what I learned in the time I was there, you know, the first day you spend, your level of awareness extends maybe 3 feet from you, 4 feet from you. And then little by little, it starts expanding. Then you start realizing, wait, there's stuff going on in this rig that's incomprehensible. And then beyond that, and then they flew me to Dallas, and I spent time in Dallas, going on in Dallas. And we had an offshore manager's office. I mean, just the magnitude of that operation was beyond comprehension. We took a rig one time from Lisbon, and I was fortunate enough to be on that rig. We took it up to the Shetland Islands to drill up there, and just preparing that rig, getting everything ready was extraordinary. Getting everything ready, get equipment ready, getting the BOPs ready, making sure everything worked, retesting. You know, you don't think of those things. We had I lost friends. We had guys get killed in plane crashes flying to the airports. We had guys lose their fingers, lose their hands on the rig. We had a guy, Glenn Tobin, in India. He fell out of the derrick. Fortunately, he was suspended and the cable caught him, but before it caught him, it cut into his inside of his leg, his thigh area, sliced them open. We had to rush him to the medic's office and the medic froze. He was an Indian medic. He froze. He didn't know what to do. So what was the guy's name? I want to say Tom Heffernan. He's the first mate. He sewed him up. He sewed Glenn Tobin's leg up after he got a big gash from that fall. I mean, it's just stuff you just can't even imagine went on. You got to keep going. You keep going. You keep going. You know, you're there for a bigger cause, and you can't forget that. If you forget that, that's when you get hurt, I think. If you forget what you're doing out there, you get hurt, or you hurt others. But all right, well, I want to thank everybody for joining me, my students especially. Thanks for hanging with us, and I will see you guys on Thursday, 11 o'clock, same time. I want to extend my appreciation for everyone that hung with us, John, Rudy, Tay, Fred, Demetrius, if you're still there. I know a couple of people left us. I don't know who's still there and who's left, so forgive me if I don't recognize you. Bill, appreciate you joining us. Aaron, good to see you all. Thank you again. Again, feel free to contact me anytime. I look forward to talking with you and look forward to working with you. And have a good day and be safe. And We'll see you on the dark side. We'll see you on the flip side. Thanks, John. Take care, you guys.